latest news, game updates, insights, highlights, and everything Liberty Hockey. This is Rock the Rink, where Liberty Hockey lives.
Things are getting interesting in the ACHA. Hey there, friends. Welcome on into Rock the Rink. Liberty sweeping Ohio on the road. Both one-goal games, but before we get to that and break it down, I think the number one topic has to be just the mayhem that went on in the top 10 of the ACHA. All right, let's kind of break this down a little bit. Pat did an excellent job of writing this through. Minot State swept by scores of 3-2 and 3-2 in a shootout by number 8 Maryville. Adrian splits with number 15 Grand Valley. They win 3-1 and then lose 3-1. UCO is swept 2-1 in OT, and then 4-2 empty net goal to number 21 Grand Canyon. They also lost 3-2 in a shootout to number 14 Utah. UNLV Cupcake Series, they win 6-1 and 5-2. Ohio is then swept by Liberty, 4-3 and 4-3 in overtime. Jamestown, which is number 6, sweeps number 9 Mary, 5-1 and 3-1. Remember, Mary knocked off Minot not too long ago. Number 7 Liberty was the one that swept Ohio. Maryville, this is where it gets really confusing for everybody at home. So they're the ones that knocked off number 1, but they also lost to number 19, 3-2 in overtime. Who knows where they're going to jump to? Mary swept by Jamestown, which we mentioned. Niagara, number 10, wins 6-0 versus Stony Brook.
But then they lose the next day because I didn't get to put this in. 6-3 to Stony Brook.
What?
So they
Niagara
split,
lost 6-3?
Yeah, they split with Stony Brook. So I didn't have a chance when I first sent this out.
Yeah.
Their score wasn't up yet.
Right.
I mean, because it was Super Bowl Sunday.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I get that. I'll give you that one. Why? Well, yeah. Well, we'll get to Super Bowl Sunday here in a little bit. We'll have some chat about that. But Annie and I actually were trying to figure out where do we think the rankings are going to land.
Yeah.
Do you want to play this game real quick?
We've been bad at it.
Yeah.
So far.
I want to start. I had an idea. We'll see. You guys ridicule. You know. And go after my thoughts. Adrian moves to number 1.
Okay.
That's my thought.
Yeah.
Minot goes to 2. UCO, I'm not sure about yet, but I'm going to say UNLV goes up to 4, to 3, that is. I think Liberty goes to 5. Then.
Wait, who's 4? UCO?
UNLV goes to 3. Liberty goes to 4.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And then I think Jamestown goes to 5. I think UCO goes down to like 6. And then after that, the only thing I don't know about is Maryville because so confusing with them. They sweep, but then they lose that tough one to number 19. I think they're on the outside of the top 5 still. Okay. I think they'll go to 7, only move up like one spot, maybe 2.
I actually have a change.
Yeah, okay.
I actually think UNLV will move to number 1.
Do you really?
Or should move to number 1. Yeah. And then
the points from Colorado.
Because everyone in front of them lost. And some of them are not the best losses for those teams. And then I would think, or this is how I think it should go. I don't think it will, but like LU jumps to 2.
Really?
Yeah.
Whoa.
Wow.
I mean, I want it. But
because when talking to Coach Forth, who we plan on getting back to the show, right? Like he said the rankings are behind a little. That's what he truly believes.
So
he hasn't fully. Input the data. So he's saying it didn't input even the split versus number 2 for Liberty.
Oh, so he, okay.
That's his theory because
his theory.
That's why things get so jumbled, even in the women's, because he's like, well, Midland played, but somehow, and we were idled, but Liberty jumped to number 1.
So basically, he believes right now that this ranking of 1 through 10, Liberty at 7, is reflective of their weekend series against
Adrian.
Not Adrian, no.
Stony Brook?
Syracuse and Stony Brook.
Weekend series, yeah, okay.
Yeah, so basically, that's weird if it is, because then, again, it's just going to get so confusing. If it really is, this is reflective of 2 weeks ago, then there's not going to be that much movement, but then all of a sudden you're going to have this massive movement in 2 weeks' time.
Right.
I hope that's not the case.
Right.
They need to get that caught up.
I know. If it's true. And I guess we'll find out on Wednesday 100%, right?
Like, oh, my goodness.
I want to see that going wild.
Yeah, because if it doesn't go wild, then you're like, okay, something's wrong with the ranking system.
This weekend of hockey, probably the best weekend of ACHA just
fun and mayhem that I've ever seen.
Right?
Like, it is just everybody was losing or splitting. Like, it's a fun weekend.
Yeah, because only three teams in the top 10 didn't lose.
Right. Crazy. Liberty, Jamestown, and UNLV.
Right.
That's crazy. Wild.
It gets me thinking of, like, this year more than any other across all divisions. Like, you just don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Like, you genuinely really have no clue.
Yeah. It blows my mind.
I wouldn't be surprised if you saw Adrian go one, UNLV go two, and Minot go three.
A lot of it depends on Grand Valley. Who were some of their quality wins this season?
Mm-hmm.
Do they have any? And that's that'd be something we can kind of check out.
Same thing with, like, Colorado State. If you're not beating them by seven, again, like, I don't know their schedule well enough, but there's some teams where it's like, okay, you beat them, but is that really going to affect your ranking?
For sure. Yeah, and even some teams like Grand Canyon, that could have been the thing that gets them in the national tournament now, right? Like, they were 21.
Yeah. Oh,
like,
sure,
I know it's
will.
24, but, like, you know how those auto bids work with teams that are outside the top 25. So, yeah, like, you got to think, like, hey, they just locked in their ticket.
Easily. Like, you think it wasn't – I don't – so do you know for sure the UCO win wasn't a shootout?
That's
the hard part.
Yeah, it was an OT win, and then I think they allowed one empty net goal, I'm pretty sure.
So then two wins. Those are two wins. It's not like the tie that happens with a shootout win. They should be. Like, you think that would boost them up into the middle teens at least.
Right. Yeah. So, yeah, and then Utah beats UCO as well. So, like, UCO dropped three, unfortunately, after the last ranking.
Right. That's wild. Yeah, it's going to, man, Wednesday's going to be a lot of fun. I almost wish we could do a mini pod just for that. That was fun. Like, really. Here's a thought. Okay, I threw this out there on Twitter. I want to get your guys' take in real time.
Okay.
I think you guys probably saw it. I texted it to you. They need to have a description of what has happened in the rankings. Like, 1 minute, audio, video, whatever you want to do. If it even just shows the video of, like, the rankings and they, I don't know, whatever, however they want to work it. Just why the movement happened.
Right.
Like, why did Liberty drop down to seven this past week? Mm-hmm. What was the purpose behind that? The small confusing things or the biggest jump, the most surprising jump? Only has to be 60 seconds long. Doesn't have to go over every single little move, but some of the more, the ones that kind of catch your eye, that would be, man, people would watch that. I would watch it.
Like, oh, for sure.
Yeah,
I'm so confused sometimes.
Yeah.
Like, what on earth is going on here?
Yeah, and it would answer your question, too, as to whether it's a week before, like, when exactly they're taking these games from.
Yeah,
because I was super confused when Liberty moved down to number seven. So I
think everyone.
That.
And then that Minot stayed number one 2 weeks in a row when they've lost, right? Mm-hmm. So you're just like, how's that work?
That would make a ton of sense. Like, I give Forth credit on that. That does make sense. Because if you look at Liberty's, I know that they won all four versus the two versus Syracuse and the two versus Stony Brook, but they weren't, like, overly convincing wins.
Right.
Like, what you would expect to do to a team in the teens. That would kind of make sense why you would drop two places. But then when you beat or split with Adrian, you're thinking you're at least standing pat, not dropping down.
Yeah.
So, right.
Yeah, wild stuff. Let's go to the weekend series, though, for the Flames. Couple of big wins over number five, Ohio. They win 4-3. They win 4-3 in overtime. A very disciplined game on both sides. Not a lot of penalties in this one. I think the big thing when you look at it here, Finch came out, and I don't know if it was listening to the Rock the Ring podcast that we were talking about, go to the net a little bit more. I don't know, but two goals for him in the OT winner.
I was going to say the unofficial video coach for men's D1, Rhett McGibbon, he said last week, he's like, Finch will be all right. He just needs to, if he's like, I like for him to go take it wide and shoot, but if he's got a lane, he needs to just go to the net.
Yes.
The OT winner makes a move, goes straight to the net.
Not a boy, Ryan.
Undresses the goaltender. Boom, back of the net. And that game, too, which credit also social media extraordinaire Meg Davis, she said the difference she feels like in this team reminds her of the team that finished second. The team has belief when they go down. And you can see that throughout this year. Like, you look at the Adrian series, the Minot State series, even though they didn't win, there were multiple games. They went down, got back, tied it, or took a lead in those series, even though they dropped. The Adrian series, up at Adrian, you're down 1-0 for most of the game. You end up winning 2-1 to split, right, up there. And then the Maryville series, you are down and come back to win 3-2 in overtime. Then you take a look at this Ohio series. You go down back and forth series, and then somehow you think in game two, they're going to clinch it. Under 3.5 to go, and they score.
Yeah.
You not only get an equalizer goal in less than a minute,
right,
but then you get the OT winner early in overtime, right? So, like, this is a team that when they go down now, they're starting to believe, hey, we can figure out a way to get the equalizer and then the go-ahead.
I think, too, that you get some bottom six contributions.
Yeah.
The one that tied it up was Gammer.
Yeah.
And that's big. Like, Gammer's not an overly big goal scorer for the team. That's not his job. But when you start getting players in the bottom six that can chip in with a little bit of help in the goal scoring department, and two, you're getting a goal from Bogenholm, Swanky's got one, like, that goes a long way to putting you into the national championship picture.
Yeah, and to both of your points there, you could start to see it and you could start to feel it off ice. Right, like most guys are going to work hard in practice and during games because it's just the sport and that's what they love. But when the team starts to buy into it in the weight room, that's when I've experienced the most success across teams. And the last couple of weeks, you just slowly start to see it build around this time. Those teams that kind of make the decision of, hey, we're going to push forward, we're going to get after it. It's just a switch that happens in the weight room, and you're really starting to see it. And then to your point too, Rhett, when I look at our lineup and I look at our roster, there's a lot of like wily vets that we have on the team, right? Guys that are battle tested, battle ready, that have been here in these situations before. And I said it to his face, and I'll say it on air. Like, if you told me 18 months ago that Nate Albers would be contributing to the team positively in the scoring column, I'm like, you're crazy. Yeah. And so last year at Nationals, though, had a breakout performance.
Yeah, he did.
It's just like all these guys are starting to come together and really showing what, again, I thought we were always capable of at the start of the year.
Do you think, going back to a point a minute ago about remembering that team that finished second, unfortunately, lost to the COVID year, do you see a little bit of that remnant in this team?
Now,
maybe not the same. I'm not talking about the makeup of the lineup, but like just in the belief and the ability that you're like, yeah, I could see them doing it.
From that perspective, then, yes.
Mm.
Yeah, there was something different in that 2020 year. We did have all of those kind of like battle-tested upperclassmen, right, who had slowly started to make that build to getting us from top 20 into top 10 into a top 5 type of team, and we still have that here. We could look up and down our roster of this is this guy's third, his fourth trip into the postseason. Just that belief and that experience is here. It's definitely here.
Yeah, and I also think getting that second win on the series was a big thing for them, especially
for sure.
After splitting against Adrian. You really wanted to put together a good game too. And I think on top of just the discipline that you saw at the same time, the way that they were able to take advantage of Ohio's mistakes in game two. You know, you have the power play goal and then also Schwenke's goal. I mean, Ohio turns it over in front of the net.
Mm-hmm.
He takes advantage. And that's the stuff that you're going to have to do going down the stretch. So I think that getting game two and the fashion in which they did it is something that's building a lot of confidence for them.
Yeah. I think the big thing right now for LU is peaking at the right time.
Yep.
Yes,
100%. You're in that area. Like, I feel like a lot of years for Liberty Hockey, you peak just before Christmas, and then you come back and you can't find it. It feels like this year is different in the sense that Liberty is really close to being, like, full tilt right now.
Yeah.
Like we said, bottom six scoring. If you can get a little healthier on the back end and tighten that up, man, I not saying Liberty's a favorite, because I don't know if there is any favorite in the
NHL. No, not this year.
But you are firmly in the mix for being able to make a deep playoff run at the Murdoch Cup. It's going to be a lot of fun to watch.
Yeah. Also, you talked about they were thin on the back end this weekend.
Yeah.
But then, like, they did a really nice job in containing Ohio's goal scorers. Laker Aldridge had no goals on the weekend. Luke Reef had one in game one. I don't think he played in game two.
Mm-mm.
But
they did it again.
No, apparently I heard the team, they're dealing with some a sickness and stuff too. So, right?
Yeah, that's true. Could be going around everywhere, right?
Yeah. Sure. But anyways, just the way that they were able to contain those guys, I don't think a single guy on that team had more than one goal on the weekend.
Right.
So that's, we talked about it going into this series, that these guys are hard to contain. There's so many of them. They're so deep. So they did a nice job with that.
Yeah. Good work by Liberty D1. Again, sweeping Ohio on the road. Tough place to play, so big win for them. Not the last time we'll see Ohio.
Nope.
In a week from now, we'll be setting that weekend series up, a weird weekend series. Thursday, Liberty is at Ohio. Saturday, they're back home. So getting a little travel in there. I don't know if they need to, you know, use up some air miles. Yeah, maybe. I'm not exactly sure. All right, moving on here. Women's Division One. I don't want to get to that yet. I do want to talk about this weekend series because Niagara is coming to town. Mm-hmm. We're so stoked about what has happened. Need to look ahead. Niagara, 18-7-1, split their weekend series this past week against Stony Brook, a tough loss, truthfully, to Stony Brook in Game 2. Last year, Liberty won 4-1 and 5-4. That was the first meeting since fall of 2016. Niagara Purple Eagles, fun team. Last year, at least, from what we saw them, skilled and fast. They are relentless. In some way, I would say they're a poor man's version of Adrian. And I hope I didn't give them bulletin board material, but they haven't won the national championships yet. So that's where the poor man aspect comes from. But this is a team that I feel like plays a similar style to that of Adrian.
Yeah, and obviously they're coming off of, even though I'm sure they didn't like that they split with Stony Brook. Yeah. They did clinch the ESCHL, which is huge for them in the second year of the conference. So, like, obviously we talked about the battle between them and Pitt. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure they're also hoping, hey, we're going to get some revenge versus Pitt in that conference championship game too, after unfortunately they fell to 8-2, I believe, to them last season. So trying to win both. But, yeah, I mean, this is an opportunity for them to build momentum and get back on the right foot after, yeah, that split versus Stony Brook. And then also for them trying to build some momentum, right? Like, they have a postseason conference tournament, and then they also then trying to build momentum heading into the national tournament too. So, like, yeah, big stakes. And you could argue this is one of Liberty's most important games, because now that they're behind and with Niagara at 10 – and that split versus Stony Brook, you don't want to falter here to a team that's probably going to be potentially five spots behind you.
Yeah, and the key stat that I have that you wrote down here, Pat, was both Liberty and Niagara being 7-1 this spring semester. So we have two teams that are fighting to keep, you know, rising in the rankings, and we have two teams that have confidence because they have just only one for the most part in the spring, and that always makes a dangerous opponent. I know, like, for me, when I see a team ranked below us, it's, you know, you can overlook them at times, and we absolutely cannot do that against a as skilled, as fast team as Niagara, who clearly can knock off some big dogs as they, you know, can be pushing into the top 10 as the rankings come out.
When you look at Liberty, what a huge opportunity you have, though. Like, you have four games left, and the message that I would give is this: you have set yourself up so well to get potentially a top two spot in the nation.
Right.
You were right on the doorstep. This weekend coming into Niagara, it's time to prove to the nation that you're a top two team.
Yeah.
Yep.
So don't mess around. Don't get into the gimmicks. Come out and play Liberty hockey. Use your speed. Play physical and just pound the number 10 team to show it. And then against Ohio, play two really strong games again, take those, and who knows where the chips will fall.
Yeah.
And you could, literally, in 2 weeks' time, could be the number one team.
Yeah.
If you played well enough, and they're more than capable of doing this, if you play well enough, you could have the top spot, home change, going into the national tournament.
Huge, right?
How big would that be?
And especially going back to, let's talk about how the year started. Right?
Like, oh, I know.
You are 6-6-1 through the first quarter of the season, and everyone's kind of like, are they the team we thought they were? You've gone 13-1 since then.
Look at you go.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, and talking about, we said belief earlier, right? Like, I think if you can do the things that we know you're capable. And in particular, Rhett has preached this a ton, and I agree. You got to win the battle in front of the net on both ends of the ice.
Yeah.
Not only protect Hunter, but more importantly, get those greasy goals,
right?
Especially against another team versus Niagara, and then when you go back versus Ohio, that have strong goaltending. Like, that's where the game is going to be won.
Right.
So, like, if they can play sound, I mean, they could do something that no team has ever done in LU history.
Right.
Yeah,
that'd be huge. Talking about the front of the net battle, that's my thing with Albers. I'm like, buddy, you are such a mountain to move. Just post up in front of the net.
Yeah.
Go watch on Amazon Prime the Don Cherry movies. he's got John Winsick just posted up in front of the net, and Battleship Kelly. Oh, my goodness. They're great movies. They get you.
They are good.
Yeah. Yeah. But no, seriously, get in front of the net and just be a mountain there. Mm-hmm. Like, in some ways, I wouldn't even worry about him going after the pucks in the corner. Just stay post in front of the net and screen the goalie.
Yeah.
Like, he could just score. I truly believe Albers could have a 15-goal year if he just parked in front of the net. Just rebounds, trash goals. They all count the same.
Like, yeah, they do.
It would just be huge. And then in front of Liberty's own net, I do think that's one area you need to clean up. There is times, and Kirk said it on when Andy was talking to him in one of these interviews here in the middle of the second. If they don't have anything to pass out with, like if they don't have a obvious outlet pass, just get it out.
Yeah.
Like that's been a couple – it's been a thorn in the side of Liberty here throughout this season is where they're just like trying to find that outlet pass instead of being like, danger, danger, just clear the puck.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's one area. If they can get literally that in their head more than anything, it's just get the puck out of harm's way. If you feel pressure against these heavy forecheck teams like Minot, like Adrian, off the glass and out, regroup, I think they go a long way.
Agreed.
Yeah.
All right. The women. I don't know if you'd say it's a tough weekend series. Like ACHA Women's Division 1-2 is in a situation where there are no clear-cut favorites, and Liberty losing 4-3 in overtime to Adrian and then winning 2-1 in a shootout.
Yeah, I think if you look at that series, like I'm sure very tough for Liberty, right? Like obviously you don't want to split with Adrian just to keep that mental fortitude over them too because you have won 10-plus versus the Bulldogs. But at the same time, like good for Liberty to regroup the next day, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, that was a very tight defensive game. And then talk about the shootout.
Oh, yeah, oh I know, right? Oh, the moves.
Right?
Like, yeah.
I'll be honest. When I first saw it, and I remember hearing the way they do shootout, like, you know, you have the competition in practice, and then, okay, if you win, which I assume Priscilla must have won. So then I was like, oh, okay, well, let's see what she got.
Yeah.
And hit him with the Dougie. Yeah. Oh, between the legs. That's all I thought. I was like, girl, didn't know you had it in you.
That was so dirty.
Right?
It was. I don't get many late night like texts from Pat, but like he's just like, oh my goodness, and shows it to us. And I was just like, that was filthy.
Right?
Like, that was such a great move. She timed it well. Spacing on the ice was key to goalies. Just like, woo.
Oh, yeah, right?
Let go.
And then Carly Glover, right? Like, with the encore. Like, roofed her between the legs. I'm like, that is so, like, and even the fans were like, oh, my God.
Right? And it's good it's getting the recognition it deserves online.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Great goal. Both of those should have gone viral.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Like, I know someone sent them out. And, yeah, they've been trending pretty well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think Liberty needs to do a remix of the Mr. Lover song or the song by Shaggy.
Okay.
Yeah, and just turn it into like Mr. Lover, Mrs. Lover, and then just go all with it.
That's so good.
Yeah. They're one of the like, smooth, just like silk is one of the lines. Yeah, there you go. That between the low. Yeah, great goals all around. All right, getting back to the more important stuff in life. Obviously, it's going to hurt in the sense that you did lose and kind of split to a degree to number three. But still, I kind of, as it stands, you obviously would love to get home ice advantage. I think that means something to Coach Lowe's. But at the same time, in that top three, it's really anybody's championship.
Right.
And I think you can see Midland, Liberty, or this year Adrian coming away with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think Carly Glover said it really well after game two. She was like, this was good for us to experience because the defensive pressure that they were bringing was, you know, it's something that we needed to see. Mm. And just knowing that that's the kind of pressure they're going to give us in the national tournament and to be reminded of that was really good for the team because, yeah, I think once you get into the tournament, it's anyone's game and you want Liberty to do what they did last year, you know, have that big comeback.
I think also too the stretch has been good for more so Alex Keith for the confidence like for her to just after a couple for last performance we talked about the Midland and the HTI game then like you go on that road trip had a great showing versus a lot of those St. Louis teams two were in the top five and then you have this big split versus Adrian like I thought that was huge too for her like building confidence and knowing like all right I can do this like I can be the backstop if called upon against these top five teams
big for her especially too no goalie likes letting in four goals
oh for sure
losing overtime to come back the next night and only allow one and to win it in a shootout great resiliency there from Keith. Liberty now preparing for Indiana Tech, number 8 in the nation. IT coming off of losses to Michigan Dearborn 3-2 and 3-2. It's been a while since these two teams have played mm-hmm. one another. Liberty has won all four matchups in that 1 year that we were talking about, 21-22, by pretty dominant scores. So this on paper is a weekend where Liberty should perform well.
Yeah, and obviously I think it's just about building confidence
yeah.
mm-hmm. heading into the conference championship, yeah. which mm-hmm. they have the week after. So like that's what I think this weekend is definitely about. Building confidence, but then also getting systematically set, right? Like, and so, like, those are two things you want to continue to keep building off of as we slowly will gear up for postseason play.
Yeah, yeah. And if you can get a solid weekend this weekend, a great showing at the conference tournament, and then going into nationals, mm-hmm. you're feeling pretty good.
Yeah. All right. Typically at this time, we do have Kerr's Corner where he gives us a health tip. Unfortunately, Kerr had a meeting today. We have to dip out on the health tip. But I thought this would be a great time to give you guys a chance to vent.
Oh, gosh.
You're both 49er fans.
Yep.
Yeah.
It was a great game, but a tough weekend
yeah.
for both of you. And I saw a new side of Annie when you guys were talking beforehand. she was like giving it. This was like Coach Annie yeah. came out. And I don't know if she can make another appearance, but still, like, take it away.
Oh, man. Well, it's good. It's good for me to talk about
yeah,
it because I just sat there, I think, for at least, like, 5 to 10 minutes after the game. I was with my dad. We were just sitting there in silence. Like, there's no way this
you
happened again.
Dad?
I was with my dad. Yes.
Did you go out west?
No. He was here.
Okay,
yeah, he
okay.
was here. It was super great. So I was super happy to watch it with him. We had a great time. But, yeah, after going through the 2019 Super Bowl loss, you know, you're so scared yeah. that's going to happen again. And then as the game went on, mm-hmm. you know, you keep going drive after drive, three and out, and you're just letting Patrick Mahomes hang around. You know, you kind of know deep down, but you think maybe it's not going to happen again.
Yeah.
And then that third quarter when you're not running the football
yeah.
and it's, you know, you kind of see the way it's going to go. And then you think maybe they can do it late in the game in the fourth. They don't. You go into OT and you're thinking, yeah, there's a slim chance this is going our way. And then, yeah, you're right there. You're like 5 yards away. Someone forgets to block Chris Jones. And before you know it, the Chiefs have a Super Bowl. So that was, it was, you know, I'm grateful that it, you know, it's better than getting blown out going to OT. But it's just another Super Bowl or big game where that was ours for the taking, Pat. And
yeah.
just couldn't get it done. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, all I thought was in that second half, you said it right there, right? We stopped running the ball. I was like, we have the leading rusher and the offensive
yeah.
player of the year. You
yeah.
need to feed him,
right.
right? Like, and then also, I thought to a certain extent, I was like, whereas like first half, we were a little bit more creative, like
mm-hmm.
with our offense. Like, you take a look at the play that scored us the touchdown.
Juwan Jennings
yeah,
pass.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, where was that? Like, stuff
yeah.
like that. I was like, you got to do that trickery. Like, even for them, the game, the play that won them the Super Bowl, right,
mm-hmm.
was the play they pulled out last year,
mm-hmm.
What they've been calling cupcake, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, so I was just like, all right. But, yeah, I just felt, like you said, if you let Patrick Mahomes,
yeah.
you need to put that nail in the coffin, and we never did. Like, you let him hang around, he will turn this game on you. And sure enough,
yeah.
he did. Like, and we didn't score off any of their turnovers, too, right?
No.
Like, we
no.
forced a fumble.
Yeah.
Forced
the interception.
Pick. Yep.
Yeah.
Didn't do anything with them.
Yeah, and I'll keep it short. I know this isn't a 49ers audience, but it is healthy. Like, like early on in Kyle Shanahan's career with the 49ers, I would always see, you know, you'd see these plays where it's like automatic touchdown. He's a genius. He sketched up this guy. He's going to be open, guaranteed touchdown. And you're thinking, last drive of the Super Bowl, like there's really nothing in his bag that he's got from all these years when it matters most.
Yeah.
Like,
he's
you know,
the Hugh Freeze of the NFL is what you're saying.
Yeah, I guess that's what I'm saying. Anyway, so yeah, not the best weekends. At least Liberty hockey won.
Yeah. Here's a question though, Purdy. Are you
yeah.
satisfied with how he played? Because I know
yeah.
you think of a guy that's not a you know like a high end pick. Is he going to be able to do it in crunch time? Were you
yeah.
satisfied?
Yeah.
I personally was. Like, I know everyone's like, oh, game manager this, that. And I'm like, well, I don't see many game managers putting up the numbers he put up this year,
mm-hmm.
for
right.
one. Two, like, also, like, first full season as a player. First year when he played that last stretch, got to the NFC Championship. This year, got to Super Bowl. If everyone has the belief and brings the same squad back, like, I think he could get the job done next year.
Yeah. And coming off that torn elbow, too.
Right.
Like, the season that he was able to put together, and especially after those first two playoff games when he didn't play that great, he had a great Super Bowl performance. So I feel confident with him going forward. And obviously, I mean, we drafted number three overall, took a quarterback, we traded him. We have to stick with Purdy for at least for a good while now.
Yeah.
Like, we got to stick with him, and I'm confident.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, especially with that salary, right?
Like, yeah, he's very he's making it easy. Yeah.
That's one thing. My, you know, let me pull this up really quick. It's not going to take me long. So my brother-in-law, also a big 49ers fan, okay? Yeah. And I said, well, at least, you know, you got a quarterback that you'll probably be back with next year. And then he goes, you know what's funny? Quarterbacks that don't typically win in their first go-round of the Super Bowl never make their way back. And so I was like, that's really funny. But then he went on this list. Goff, Burrow, Garoppolo, Matt Ryan, Cam Newton, Kaepernick, Rex Grossman, or Grossman, McNabb, Jake Delhomme, Rich Gannon, Dave Brown, he's going back, McNair, Jeff George. That's all the way back to 1998. That. So he's like, I hope Purdy can break that. But I think what you said was key. So many of these guys make the Super Bowl, and then it's payday.
Yeah.
And so the fact that he has a low cap hit, they can surround him with quality O-line, get your D-line straight. Like, you know, the important
parts. Yeah, and we don't have a lot of guys that we have to pay this offseason. Yeah. I think you want to pay Brandon Ayuk. Juwan Jennings is probably gone just because of the Super Bowl performance he put out there, and he is a free agent. But, like, it's not the end of the world if you lose Juwan Jennings. Yeah. Like, when you look at the grand scheme of things, you still have all your key pieces. It's just so hard to get back to the Super Bowl. But they can do it.
Yeah.
They
can do it.
I believe.
All right. Great stuff. Before we get back to ACHA action, I did want to bring up one hockey thing. I was talking about it before. This has been a hot topic in the NHL, but it's Morgan Riley.
And oh, yeah.
Riley, I don't know if it's Greg. I don't even want to say the guy's name. Riley Gregg, I think it is, from Ottawa Senators. Buddy does a clapper into the open net. What are you thinking? Like, yeah, I watch this, and Riley goes after him, and I have my own takes. I watched this. I had a good breakdown of it where the cross-check, and use Annie here, comes in towards the arm, but he puts his hand up. It glances off the hand and hits him in the neck. So, did hit him in the neck. I'm not saying it didn't, but I believe the target was the arm. You're going to suspend this guy, and as of right now, we don't know what the suspension is, but I'm guessing it's going to be 6 games. Give me a break.
Yeah.
Like, give me a stink. But that guy, in my mind, should not have walked off the ice. Like, if you do that kind of garbage, Ryan Reeves of the Leafs actually said, make hockey violent again. And I agree. Like, if there was somebody in Liberty that, like, on the opposition that clappered in the net, I'd be like, yeah, I don't care who you are. You go. Finish him off. Yeah.
That's right.
You know, give him the old Gestapo treatment. Like, you know, break his legs. I don't know. But, like, it fired me up.
Yeah. No, I agree. Like, you see it, and everyone, I know all the people are like, why did he go after him? And that? And I'm like, it's like one of those unwritten rules. Yeah. Like, what do you do? Like, you could just sauce that thing in, right? Like, ain't no need to do all that. And, yeah, I think Riley did what he was supposed to do. Like, right? Like, someone totally took him out after, right?
For him.
Yeah.
Morgan Riley may, if the team responds, may have saved the Leafs season.
That's true. Like, everyone could rally around. Like, that's not right.
Right. Buy in and be, like, just rough for the rest of the year. It reminded me, this is going back, 2004, I believe it was, when Calgary had their cup run and lost in 7 to Tampa. But it was in the first, I think it was the first round of, like, that playoff series. They're taking on San Jose. I think it was game 3. They're about to go down 2-1. And this rookie for San Jose named Korluk, open net. Does he just send it in? No. He throws on the brakes in the slot and then scores. And I remember it was Chris Simon just, like, put him 6 feet under, right? Like, just buried the guy. At that time, Chris Simon was a hero. I don't, things have changed in the last 20 years, obviously. But I wish we could go back to those days. Anyways, that's my take.
Right.
And I know this probably wouldn't be a coach's sentiment, but, like, if somebody did that in the ACHA, you better take care of business. I'm just going to.
Don't disappoint Rhett.
No,
that's
don't
right.
disappoint me. Otherwise, you'll hear about it. I don't know about that. All right, Men's Division 2. 2-1 versus the Northeast. They lose 5-2, two empty net goals in this contest versus number 2 Keene State, who they had just swept not too long ago
right.
at the LIC. But then they do win 9-5 versus number 4 UMass and 3-2 in overtime versus number 1 Northeastern. So with all this being said, sets them up pretty well, I would believe, for a top 2 spot in the Southeast, given that number 3 Indiana lost in the first round of their tournament play. So what, Pat? You're the guru, I would say, of this stuff. Kind of, how are you feeling right now? Do you think they have that bye?
Yeah, I would think so. Okay. Like, if I would be more shocked, because I don't think Miami, Ohio, who they swept as well right. before they hit the road for this Northeast trip, did enough to propel them above. Well, really, 2 spots, because they would have to jump Indiana and Liberty.
Yeah.
And I think the fact that Liberty was able to beat the number 4 by 4 and you come away with a win over
number one,
that's big, right? Like, so like, I think that does do you some favors. And then also too, you're 2-1 versus Keene State on the year. Mm-hmm. So like, that's big as well.
Yeah.
And I think Liberty, from you think a metric standpoint, has done enough to probably lock in the number 2 spot. Now, is that what they wanted? Which this is good, because we're going to get fine. Coach Hughes said he would come on next week to obviously recap the year and preview a little bit of national. So, like, we can hear a little bit about his take on if he's excited or if he wanted. Maybe we should have gone to the regional stage, even though that's what we talked about all year. But that's not the case now for Liberty. And this is a team, I think, it sounds like they're starting to believe as well now.
It does.
Right?
Like,
so. You get your captain back in Harrell, and I think that goes a long way.
Yeah, and I also think that this doesn't really count from a metric standpoint, but looking at the way that they won those other games, first of all, that game against Keene, their goaltender had an amazing day. I mean, Liberty outshot them 31-22. The third period, I mean, the majority of it in Keene's D zone, and just, I mean, the guy was making amazing saves, played a great game. But then I think that the fact that you're on this 3-game road trip, you're going up and down day after day, and you go up against number 1 Northeastern, who hasn't played a game in 8 days, and then you beat them in OT, like, I think that was huge. Because if you lose that game, you're kind of looking at that weekend, oh, we went 1-2, not the best, but then you walk away with it with the win, completely changes your perspective.
Right.
So I think that from a confidence standpoint, that was huge for them.
Yeah, and I think, too, you lose the first game of the road trip. Mm-hmm. You could have easily turtled over the rest of it and not lost your mojo, but you found a way to get 2 big wins versus the defending champs, and then also, like you just said, Andy, versus the number 1 team in the Northeast, who has an auto bid as well.
Big weekend for Matley. 3 goals, 4 apples. Good on you, kid. Higgins, 3 goals, 2 assists. Kent, 2 goals, 2 assists. Starkey with 2 goals. Mulder, and is it Vidal? I don't want to.
I believe stuff.
2 apples. So the captain coming back with a goal and assist as well. Skon, as we mentioned, doing well. So they finished the regular season, the Flames, D2, 19-9-1. And we said, looking pretty solid, like they are going to be able to hold on to that number 2 spot in the Southeast region. It would have been interesting. I think people would have had knots in their stomach if Miami of Ohio had been able to win game 2 versus Liberty.
Then it would have gotten very interesting, especially after this weekend and the weekend Miami just had. Because they had to win 3 games to win their conference tournament. So
that would have been big. But Liberty coming back in that second game, which you're speaking of, and taking it. So big for them. All right, men's division 3, whole Coastal Carolina. Those teal chickens. Split in the weekend series versus LU, winning. LU wins 5-4 in overtime and then lose 4-3. So Liberty with that continues their I wouldn't say, would you say inconsistent? It's just always a battle.
Yeah.
I guess it is. It's your rival, right? Like, it's hard to just dominate your rival because then it's not a rivalry anymore.
Yeah. And, I mean, it doesn't all, you always talk about it, but things just go out the window for a rival. It doesn't matter who's got the better record. It doesn't matter if one team's having a down year. Like, when it comes to those rivalry games, it's going to be a dogfight throughout the whole matchup, and that's what we saw for the whole weekend. Now the question is, like, how will it play out for the conference tournament if they do meet up there? Like, that will be the one where it will get real interesting.
And I think just from talking with some people on the team, they said, like, man, that first game, that second game was an absolute killer. I mean, they wanted that so bad. And I think that they said what they learned was, you know, 5-on-5, we're playing our best hockey. Like, that is where we are really doing well right now, but it's just those mistakes, those penalties,
right.
Taking too many of those. And it really was a wake-up call. Like, know that we can win the national championship this year, and we feel like we have all the guys to do it. We have all the goal scorers, whatnot, but it's just, you know, those mistakes, we can't do it to ourselves. Yeah. And yeah, so I think this next weekend too is going to be pretty interesting, because now, you know, the rankings start to come into play and you have to start paying attention to that again. So yeah, it's going to be pretty interesting going down the stretch.
Yeah, Liberty take on App State next, February 17th and 18th. App State coming off a sweep of CNU, winning 6-0 and 5-3. Liberty as well swept CNU by pretty big numbers earlier this year. We'll keep an eye on that. To close things out, Women's Division II, they close their regular season with a win. So they tie and then against Lawrence Tech and then also beat them 2-0. Is it enough? That's the question. I don't know if Rena Leone is going to sleep until the final ranking.
Oh, yeah.
That and poor woman.
Very understandable.
Yeah. They finished the year 11-6-2. The playoffs are coming up. Do the playoffs count in that ranking process?
Part of me thinks it does.
Okay. Yeah. So at least you can continue to cement your case to be
right.
to be there. But, yeah, that's the big question. Are the Flames going to make it this year to Nationals?
That's right. Yeah. But key note on the victory game two.
Yeah, hit it.
Dondi.
Came out again.
Oh, that's right.
That's right. He is fueling the Flames big time right now.
He better come out to all the rest of Liberty hockey games.
I know. Right? He's got to come out to the women's tournament, right?
Yeah.
He's dialed in.
He knows when the big games are. He knows when he has to show up.
Yeah.
He's doing a good job.
With a name like Dondi, it just feels like there's some magic in the air.
That's right. You know, I always say, the Dondi. And my wife's like, who's that? It's like, Dondi Costin. She's like, oh, why do you say the before his name?
Yeah.
And I was like, because he's the Dondi.
Yeah, that's right. He's got them magic ways.
That's right.
Things are going well. Yeah, be a lot of fun to watch. We'll keep a finger on the pulse of Women's Division II. And as soon as news breaks, we'll bring it
here on Can't
the
wait.
Rock the Rink podcast. Well, fun weekend of hockey again. What a weekend it was in ACHA Division I last weekend. So much turmoil that went on for a lot of the top teams involved in the league, and we'll keep our eyes closely on the rankings that come out. Dub, I think you should tweet out your thoughts here. PW85.
Oh.
Yeah, when the rankings come out, I think Pat needs to do
that's
it.
Right, yeah. Don't worry, I'll put everyone on it, too.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Like, guys, what happened?
Yeah, tag us in there. Well, it'll be a fun discussion. Remember that, you know what, before we go, back in the day, the old message boards, do you remember those?
Are they
still even around?
I don't know, but I do. The biggest thing I remember, the thread we had when we used to do the ranking show, and we did that preseason show, and then we got chirped by one person, but they tagged all of us, and then we just all hit him with a fact, and he just refuted it.
I don't remember, young man
from Rutgers.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Right? And like, we were just like, what?
Well, Rutgers went on to call us a cult.
Then Danny Logan responded with the best answer ever.
He just ended him. We'll leave it there. Anyways, great times. We'll be back here next week. Hard to believe hockey season wrapping up here in a few weeks' time. It's getting near the end, but fun stuff so far. More fun to come. We'll see you next week on Rock the Rink.